they just fired me on the spot, which I know a lot of people might have been a bit upset by that, but I actually felt so liberated because I can finally do something that I wanted to do.
Hey investors, Bradley here from Watson Estates, and you're listening to the largest, fastest growing podcast for Toronto real estate on iTunes, Spotify, and Google Podcasts. We love to keep track of what's going on in the news and in the media and being informed on what's going on in prices and all that fun jazz in the GTA. But at the same time, I love to keep my finger on the pulse on who is winning, who is experiencing success in our market, and what exactly are those investors doing? Well, today I have a fellow podcaster, George El Masri, who I call George's in the podcast, which is super embarrassing. Let's just pretend that didn't happen. But George also has a podcast called The Well Off Podcast, where he interviews many, many successful investors. Some we've had on our show, many we have not had on our show. And I encourage you to check that out as well. But I wanted to give him a platform to share his story, share his journey, and the success that he's experienced in his market. And we have those kinds of conversations, things he looks for, and some kind of advice he would give if you're thinking about investing in real estate. If you could, please hit the like button, subscribe to our channel, and enjoy the show. Georges, thank you for being on the show. How's it going?
It's going very well. Thanks. Thanks for having me.
It feels like not that long ago we were over on your podcast. Maybe tell our audience a good, we'll start right off the beginning with a bit of a plug. Where can people find you? What's your show all about?
Yeah, welloffpodcast.ca. It's on all the major platforms as well. And it's pretty similar to this. It's a lot of real estate investors and entrepreneurs that come on and share their journey and their stories.
Yes. And you have an amazing story today. I like to take podcasters that have a good following, but often will highlight or feature other people, but don't have a platform to do it themselves. And today I really think it'll be a good conversation for us to dive into your story a little bit, get to know kind of what you've come through and how you're investing. Obviously you've learned stuff along the way. Podcasts have a way of teaching you that way, but I want to get to know a little bit about why you do what you do. What have you found to be successful, your strategies? And we could talk a little bit about that, some of the things you've learned along the way. I think this is a really good introduction. It's something I know I am. I love to learn through stories and hear some of those experiences. So I'm really hoping we could, does that sound like a plan?
Yeah, sure.
Perfect. So tell us, so for our audience, tell us a little bit about you. Where have you come through? Just give us a bit of your history into real estate.
Sure. Yeah. Well, I actually started off, so I went to the University of Toronto, and while I was there, I was working an office job. I was doing quality assurance, and then I ended up going, joining full time after I graduated, not knowing what I wanted to do and whatnot, but I hated the job. Every single day was the same thing, just repetitive, no growth, and it was super boring. So I remember one day being called into the office after about like 2-3 years of working there, and they just called me in at 4:55 PM. So I knew that wasn't good news. And the lawyer was there and my manager was there, and they just basically let me go. They just fired me on the spot, which, I know a lot of people might have been a bit upset by that, but I actually felt so liberated because I can finally do something that I wanted to do. After a couple months of trying to figure it out and like just exploring different options and whatever, I thought, what can I do every single day in the next 5 to 10 years and be happy? And I always wanted to be a real estate investor. So I thought, okay, let me get my real estate license. I'll get my foot in the door that way, learn the business. And then when the time is right, I'll start investing in real estate. And that's kind of what kicked off my journey.
Yeah, it's funny. I remember when I left my corporate to go into real estate, not into investing, but into real estate. So entrepreneurship in a sense. It was funny because maybe you didn't get the same pleasure, but all the other employees were happy for me. And I got this sense that that's a common thing. People want to have a platform to do that. In your case, your hand was forced, but it sounds like if they didn't let you go, you probably would have done it yourself. It was just a matter of time.
I was thinking about it for months and I just didn't take action. I just thought, okay, whatever. I got a steady paycheck. I'll just keep doing this. And then eventually they did it for me, which was awesome.
Now, also, maybe not a promotion to just quit and run away. Obviously, there needs to be a strategy in place. Maybe that would have been a little different. But so you were left in a scenario where like, okay, I want to do something for, you said, 5 to 10 years. Where did you go from there? What was kind of the transition for you?
Yeah, so it took me about 6 months after getting fired to figure it out. And then I signed up for the courses. And eventually I joined Royal LePage. This was back in 2013. Yeah. And I just worked on my own, which was a stupid idea. Actually, I did one deal in my first year. It was a real struggle. Like, it was so tough to go off on my own and just make my own, survive off my commission and whatnot. And then, things picked up from there and things got a lot better.
Yeah. So on the real estate salesperson side, what markets were you working in at that time?
At that time I was in Mississauga and I was working in Brampton as well.
Okay. So I know, but maybe for our audience sake, where did you go since then? Cause you've obviously shifted markets. Was that just did you move further out, or how did that, why make the shift? Why not just stay in those marketplaces?
To be honest, I'm not really selling as actively. My wife is also a realtor and she's doing more of that. So what I do is I focus on investment properties in Hamilton, Welland, and St. Catharines. Those are my three cities. And I went out there I started off in Hamilton because that was like one of the only places I could afford. This was a few years ago. And I just realized there's a lot of opportunity here and just started growing the portfolio.
Yeah. So, all right. So we've got a bit of context on the history. What I think would be a good conversation is you've obviously fine-tuned it and you've got your own strategy, which is the BRRR strategy. We haven't on our show talked about it in a long time, and we say BRRR more than the average person. So I think it'd be good for us to kind of do a recap on what that looks like and what that looks like for you, because it's not necessarily the same for everyone. And how do you kind of approach those deals today?
Yeah, well, the first two properties I bought, I did the BRRR strategy on just because I heard somebody talk about it. I'm like, oh, that makes a lot of sense. We'll do it. But yeah, you basically buy a property where you can add value somehow, either cosmetically or by adding an additional unit, converting the property. There are multiple ways to add value. And then once the renovations and the changes are complete, you go back to the bank and refinance for a higher amount to withdraw your capital.
So is that strategy what you still do that today, or how often or frequently have you been how long and how frequently have you done that?
I do that for every property. And what I do is I have a spreadsheet, a return on equity spreadsheet. So I'm constantly monitoring how much equity we have in our properties. And when we get to a certain point, then we look at refinancing. And so that way we can either renovate another property or we can continue to grow.
Yeah. I know before the show, you were telling me about a triplex and a fourplex you were working on. Maybe give that as an example, because I know there was some transition that happened. Maybe share with our audience what that move looked like and how that worked out.
Yeah. So my wife had a condo. This was before we were together. She bought this condo and she lived there for a while. And then when we moved in together, she rented out her condo in Toronto, north end of Toronto. And then as you guys are aware, last year there was a big dip in the market when it comes to rents in the Toronto market. So her tenant decided to leave because he was able to find like the same property for $500 or $600 less a month. You know, so we did some research and figured it out and realized carrying this place is going to cost about $400 a month. And it just didn't make sense. So we're like, okay, let's just sell it. We'll take the proceeds and we'll go and reinvest it in something that makes more sense. So we ended up buying a fourplex last year using the funds that we got from the condo. And then we also bought a triplex this year. Again, we still had some funds from there. So basically we turned a single unit condo in Toronto into 7 units in the Niagara region, in the Niagara and Hamilton region. It was a huge difference, cash flow positive versus negative cash flow. And long-term, I think this is going to be so much better for us.
Yeah. I'm talking to clients right now who are pre-approved. They're in a better than average position. They're pre-approved to buy a condo, single family home, for $900,000. I'm having a conversation with them and introducing them to multifamily. I know you do 3 to 5 unit type properties. So having that attitude of getting more doors. Now some people freak out in the multifamily, fine. Even in a triplex and fourplex perspective, I see that. I see the cash flow. Even if you don't go that much further, I mean, I know your opportunities are significantly greater than what we see in the GTA for cash flow. And obviously there's a balance between equity and cash flow. But even still, if we go in a multifamily home in the GTA, you're miles ahead. You're miles ahead.
Yeah, definitely. The only thing is, if you are somebody who doesn't want to commit a lot of time to this, having that one condo is probably better for you. because like you don't need to hire a roofer and somebody to replace the furnace usually and that type of thing. It's all kind of taken care of as part of your condo fees. Right. So yeah, you have to be a lot more hands-on. It's going to take more time if you're buying a multi-unit property, at least to stabilize the building. And then once you've turned the units over and you've put in the right tenants and whatnot, it becomes a lot easier.
What kind of period do you usually see? So I haven't talked actually on, as I'm thinking about it, with any guests about stabilization. What is that period of time? What is a typical stabilization for your three and your fourplex to get those in Ontario? I guess that's important to note as well.
Well, here's the thing. I've been buying properties with vacant possession lately. So that makes things a lot easier and a lot faster. But yeah, so some like that fourplex we bought last year, we inherited two non-paying tenants. They didn't pay from day one, and it took us 9 months to evict them from start to finish. So once they were evicted, we renovated their units. So let's say it took about, I don't know, 12 to 14 months start to finish to stabilize that building. We did have one vacant unit there. So basically we turned over three out of the four units in within 14 months.
Yeah. When I hear some of the stories out of province, I'm amused, you know, 6 months, no problem, in and out stabilization. But in Ontario, there's a lot of these hoops to jump through, and I don't blame you when you say, yeah, people will default to a condo. I think it's why we see a lot of people moving outside the city to condos as well. It's not just within Toronto. The condos have gone up. It's actually gone up quite a bit in the GTA as well for that reason. That kind of, whether if you're trying to get the cash flow, you put a significant enough down payment, and we see a lot of foreign money, you know, just parking it because as long as they can break even, they're satisfied. The other side I know on a multifamily is generally you've got this challenge of utilities, right? You got this balancing act that needs to take place. Do you tend to put separate meters, or how do you maneuver that with the multis?
Yeah, a lot of the ones we have already have separate hydro meters, but we're paying for gas and water. But we bought one property that didn't have separate hydro meters, and we actually used Wise Meter. It's a company where they install their own hardware in the property,
yeah,
and they connect it to the internet somehow, and
it's
then
a device, yeah,
and then it splits the hydro, and basically the tenants pay this company, and the company will pay me back for the hydro amount that they owe.
Yeah, I learned about that this past year. I don't know how long that's been in place, but definitely worthwhile. Instead of doing all these separate meters, you can track the usage, and they can split them up, but not in a way that requires different meters. So do you, if you move into a property that isn't separate meters, do you apply that, or do you look specifically, because obviously that's a big, it's still a reasonable expense, or are you looking, are you holding out for that vacant property separately metered, you know, like you're making sure every box is checked? I'm wondering what's the flexibility, because some people come in, I mean, you said you assumed tenants that weren't paying. That's a risk that you took. So I know there's a level, where are you okay with risk? And where is it like, no, this is something I'm not going to budge on?
Well, if you get a property for the right price, you'll take on the risk, right? Like, what does it cost? Let's say 15 grand to evict two tenants between missed payments and paralegal fees and whatever else. But if you bought the place for 100 grand under market value, then it balances out. You just got to account for it, right? But yeah, we're not necessarily looking for like a vacant property with separate meters. We'll do that stuff ourselves if we have to. Again, it all comes down to price, but we would prefer vacant possession. The way things are in Ontario, like having vacant possession is a huge advantage, because the tenants we're picking are usually a lot better than the ones that have been there for 20 years, or, you know, like you get a certain type of tenant in these properties out in the Niagara region. So yeah. We just try to be careful with that.
Yeah. While you're mentioning that, it reminds me, we were looking at a place in, it was Southwest Ontario. I can't remember what city it was, but it was off market, great opportunity. But the tenants that were in there were government subsidized. It was like the government had stepped in, done all of this work, which really, if you think about it, was not worth it, but they were tied to the CMHC rents in that area. And that was enough of a deal breaker to say, we don't want to assume that for the next, it's 10 years, but let's say it was 3 to 4 years remaining. It just didn't make sense with those numbers. So not only do we have an issue with vacants, like removing tenants, which is obviously a struggle between landlords and tenants, but then you also have policies in place that completely remove your ability to do it, even if you were ready to. So now today, are you doing these by yourself for the most part? Do you have partners that you're working with? How have you been navigating that now that you have a little bit of a system on the go?
Yeah, we do some projects on our own, but we also have partners as well. We prefer having partners, obviously, but in certain situations where we just have to move forward, we find a deal and we just move forward on our own if we can. So we're open to either option.
Do you wholesale any of these opportunities or not really?
No, not really. I'm not really a wholesaler. I do find deals for clients, but more focused on like our own projects.
Yeah. And generally you're holding them. The plan is to renovate and hold.
Yeah. Like we have a couple that we like that condo, for example, and we have another one that we're going to probably sell because they just don't fit our model anymore.
Yeah.
So as long as they fit the model, we keep them. Otherwise we look to dispose or figure it out.
So as you've looked back, I know one of the things that you said was a big influence. And again, back to kind of the story was your parents. Maybe you can tell us a little bit about what happened there and how that's maybe influenced the way you do business today.
Sure. Yeah. So my parents are Lebanese. I'm Lebanese too, technically, although I was born here, but anyway, they immigrated to Canada before I was born. And the reason they came here is because there was a civil war in Lebanon, obviously. So yeah, they had a really tough childhood. They came here to give us a better life. And when they came here, although like they did everything, they're great parents. They're awesome parents. They did so much for us, but I just feel like they didn't really understand how money works. And so I made it a point to become wealthy so that I can break the cycle or create like this new reality for us as a family. And so that my kids can grow up not never having to worry about money. So that was like a huge inspiration for me just to see the struggles that they had to go through and to think I've got this awesome opportunity in a great country where you could be successful if you work at it. And that's just been my motivation and what has led me taking on all these projects and all this risk and all this stress. That's what it is.
I love that. So like when I look, I'm a first generation grad, and similar, not nearly the same, as far as like international. I'm Canadian for several generations, but one of the things that my parents have always kind of stood on as their rock, and it maybe, I don't know if your parents can relate, is the move that they made from Lebanon to Canada, the move my parents made to equip us to be who we are today was a success. So you're almost, although it feels like you're kind of starting a new train, in many ways, it's a baton that that we have available to us. And being able to come across real estate is a, I don't know what you'd call it, but it's just like a turbo. It's an engine that lets you go faster. I'm sure you do too, because you're doing it, but it's beautiful. It's an absolutely beautiful vehicle to build wealth. And I know you've been able to interview many people, who have, like we have, that have, had success and been able to do it in their own unique ways. For someone who wants to get started or scale, right? Cause I know financing is one of the hardest things right now. And obviously joint ventures is an opportunity, but like, what are some things that you tell a new person to consider as they're thinking about beginning their journey?
Yeah, I actually just wrote like a little article that we're sending out to our clients, about a 27-year-old that I just worked with who bought her second property. And she's like, she did it on her own. She doesn't come from a rich family, didn't get an inheritance or anything like that, has an average job. So what she did and what I always recommend doing is just buying something that you can afford, even if it's not in your city. If let's say you live in the GTA, go ahead and buy something outside of the GTA that you can afford, rent it out for a few years, and then you'll eventually have enough equity to refinance it and continue to grow your portfolio. So that's what I recommend to people. Like don't worry about buying a primary residence right now if it's out of reach. Go and get yourself a rental property and it'll open tons of doors for you.
Good advice. I think that's great advice. What we're seeing now is other companies moving in and breaking up real estate and corporations. You can buy kind of shares, and we're starting to see technology play a big role in people to allow them that opportunity. But I would agree with you. you'd be better off getting something that's yours further out or with fewer partners that's further out. And what I'm kind of hearing in there is take action instead of, you know, waiting, saving, which is a 25, I think, some odd year journey in Toronto to get a deposit, is take action now while it's feasible and deal with the primary residence later. I think because we do, and I'm guilty of this too, we talk about house hacking all the time. It's such a fantastic opportunity people have. And then first time home buyers, right? Because you in some ways forfeit your first time home buyer buying an investment property first. But those things are, the first time home buyer is such a small aspect of the whole equation, and people sometimes will, to save a penny, will sacrifice the dollar. And I think what you're saying is right. I think that's and I think there are more people waking up to that. Have you noticed any shift as you're kind of talking generationally? Because I think young people were seeing more and more wanting to get involved. Are you seeing that from some of the conversations you're having? How has the attitude towards real estate shifted?
Oh, I think the majority of young people are interested in getting property, like in buying property, but I think a lot of people don't know how to do it. And then, like you said, they get stuck on the little things. Like I know you must come across this too, but sometimes people will say, well, I just want to save up. They have like say 15% down. They go, no, I want to save up 20% so that I can avoid the CMHC insurance, the insurance premium. But they don't realize that doing that, the prices could jump by 10, 20, 30% by the time they've saved up that additional 5%, and they're just in the hole and they get priced out or whatever. So yeah, I mean, people need to get more educated, but not too much. Just have enough education, take the leap. I don't think anyone really knows exactly what they're doing when they get started, but you just have to have enough education to survive and be somewhat successful.
Yeah. And it's very much a bit of a bearish attitude, right? I know when I'm looking at articles, people putting 5% down on a condo, they'll buy it. But then the concern is as prices for condos come down. And for a period there, people were actually in the hole as far as equity to the point where they couldn't sell. So there's this big, like, that's like a worst case. I'm going to lose everything. And then some, I can't sell because I can't pay the fees to sell it and get absolutely stuck. And then there's this kind of over analysis that happens. I think with what you're doing and having multiple units or a bit of a stream of income there safeguards and allows you, if the numbers work, which they should, or what are you doing, allows you to carry through those times, because history shows us they're few and far between. And yes, they can be dramatic, but they do come back. And how is the attitude towards the condo different than your multi? Like, how do you treat those? Or is it just kind of... you've got revenue, you've got expenses, and then that's it? Or do you look at it from the perspective of like, if I get a 4-unit, obviously I'm going to have higher vacancy. Like, how do you manage, like what's geared you towards those 3 to 5 units, that not a 10 unit and not a 2 unit, let's say?
Yeah. Well, I'm not opposed to a 10 unit. I'd love to get into that type of thing. But yeah, in terms of condos, like personally, it doesn't fit my model. I'm not interested in it. I don't want to own technically shares in a corporation, because that's kind of how it is. I want to own land. With that land, I can rebuild. I can rezone. There's so much I could do with it. And the land is what's appreciating. So that's the way I look at it. I'm not saying that it's wrong to go after condos, but I mean, a lot of people have been able to do that successfully, but just personally, like I said, I want to focus on the land. And multis, again, it mitigates your risk. They're usually cash flow positive. So a lot of benefits to doing that, as opposed to just having a single unit where if that tenant stops paying rent and you have to evict them and your mortgage payment's like $3,000 a month, then you're putting out a lot of money to cover that mortgage. By the time they get evicted, you're going to be what, like 15, 20 grand in the hole.
So out in Welland, I don't think we've had too many people from that direction, St. Catharines, Welland area. So for people who want to invest, are you working with capital partners right now? How can people kind of get a hold of you if they want to get involved in some of these opportunities you're talking about?
Yeah, definitely interested in working with capital partners, and they can reach out to me. And if you want to email me, it's invest@welloff.ca, or you could just go to welloff.ca and contact info is there. But yeah, lots of awesome opportunities in Welland. That's one of my favorite markets. I like St. Catharines as well.
I really like Welland. I was actually just Now the time this is coming out, it's probably been a month ago we were looking at these, but I'm looking at some of them well and is in definitely in my short list of areas that I see as lots of opportunity. So I think you've got a pretty good system in place. You're in the right markets. I think there's a lot ahead. And I know you've had some incredible guests. Some of we've overlapped and some we haven't. So I would encourage the audience, go jump over to the Well Off podcast, find it on iTunes, Spotify, any of those. And is there any other social platforms people can get a hold of you or track what you're doing?
Yeah, I've got a YouTube channel as well. But yeah, I mean, those are the main ones there.
Beautiful. Well, Georges, appreciate you taking the time to come over and join us over here on Toronto's number one real estate podcast. And we'll keep an eye on what you're doing and track it in the future.
Sounds good, Brad. Thanks a lot.